My guest tonight is Jay Dyer. He has generously agreed to return to discuss his series on Tragedy and Hope. He just completed the second part, Tragedy and Hope, a golden bank for international shakedowns. Of course, Jay is the proprietor of Jay's Analysis. Jay, how are you doing tonight?
Doing well, Tim. How are you?
Very well, very well. Listen, this was the second part. Your first part was Tragedy and Hope 1, Bankster Revolutions, where we talked about, the introduction or the imposition of the gold standard, gold certificates, Bankster frauds, revolutionary ideals being promoted by the banksters, the dialectics of classical liberalism, other things, false flags, the planned assassinations that led to World War I to disrupt society to create the New World Order. That was kind of the first part.
Right.
The second part, you talk about the Bank of International Settlements and the financial shenanigans that the elite were doing right after World War I. So how do you want to get into this?
Yeah, well, so the last talk and my talk dealt with about the first 250, 300 pages, and then the next talk was content rich, so it dealt with about 100 pages, but was full of juicy niblets and nuggets. And so, yeah, I was just kind of blown away at, you know, even you really have to trudge through this, you know, this tome, and you really will find these golden nuggets here and there, like the golden nuggets stashed beneath in an underground base below the Bank of England that that can be flooded by Montague Norman at his behest via a button upon his desk. So, yeah. Really what we get into in the second lecture is the subject of the preeminence of the banking class and the consolidation into what Quigley terms finance capitalism. Well, excuse me, monopoly capitalism out of finance capitalism. And so really these terms that he's talking about do not, in my opinion, signify a change of power. It's not one group losing power to another group per se, as much as it is he's describing the mechanics of how these systems work. So finance capitalism was a period where you had a lot of investment banking that would propel the economy. And then this is going to transition into the period that, you know, up into when Quigley's writing in the Cold War era, the period of monopoly capitalism. So you have commercial capitalism, and this would be the period of, you know, the East India Company and the other big licensed crown companies working at the behest of these older imperial models, British Empire and so forth, Dutch East India Company. And this transitions into the period of finance capitalism, and then that transitions into the period now of monopoly capitalism. So that's where we're moving into, is out of that finance period, which would be, you know, around the Depression era, according to Quigley, and then into huge industrialization, particularly the immense wealth of the U.S., which will lead the U.S. to becoming a major world power, unfortunately run by a global shadow elite, a banking elite. And that's the sum total of pretty much everything that Quigley says about World War I, post-World War I. He does say in almost explicit terms that the boom-bust cycle and the Depression and the subsequent war debts and reparations were all engineered by the bankers. And this was, of course, at the behest of Colonel House with Woodrow Wilson and the 14-point plan. And that was instrumental in, as we would see eventually, the Bank for National Settlements in 1930 being established. And this provokes, in part, Germany into the Second World War with these massive unpayable reparations. And I think that was what was most striking, was the outrageous loan sharking on the part of the Western banking establishment that the Germans couldn't pay. And so they would pay these outrageous amounts, billions of dollars a year. And then the Western banking elite would just say, oh, well, we didn't actually receive any of your payments, so you still owe us more. That's what Quigley says. I mean, unless he's making that up. I mean, it's the omissions are just, I guess, the most amazing part of the book. But But so, yeah, that's where we get up to is the period of what's going to lead to World War II and how this banking cartel really extends its central Federal Reserve model to all the nations, at least as it's in the process of conquering the nations, is what I'm trying to say. Then the way to do that is through creating a centralized group known as the Bank for International Settlements in Basel, Switzerland. And this group will coordinate and have its own secret set of books for monetary exchanges, exchange rates, and global currencies, and all of the major nations' central banks. And so the board of seven, I believe it was, is just made up of, you know, the largest countries that you would presume, the U.S., Japan, Britain, and so forth. And they're all kind of based on the Bank of England model, according to Quigley. So it does get a little bit more complicated to get into unorthodox monetary theory. This would be Austrian and so that's what in the background and admitted by design.
Hello, can you hear me? Hello? I'm getting a bad connection.
Oh, I'm sorry. What was the last thing I said?
Well, the Bank of International Settlements. You're describing how it was set up and how they have a dual books they keep.
Yes, and so basically I was just making the point that that's what is going on in the background behind these world wars. And the wars have multiple purposes of, you know, of course, reorganizing social order as well as exacting mass debts on the nations that lose. But as we can see, the banking and corporate elite fund both sides of these wars. Mm-hmm. And that allows for the need for entities like the League of Nations, the United Nations, to be created under the guise of world peace and the enforcement of reparations. And that's what's so devastating to Germany. Quigley admits it's devastating to the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which loses over 50% of its size and population. In terms of the war, the post-war settlements. So you just have a big, that's why I called it the Golden Bank of International Shakedowns, because that's what dominates that next 100 pages of Quigley.
And also, the breakup of the Austro-Hungarian Empire created these weak successor states.
Yes.
Set the stage for the Second World War, because you have Germany making these claims via, you know, vis-a-vis.
About which properties are theirs, right? And what, yeah.
And, you know,
but it's the, also the debts. I mean, the debts are just phenomenal that Quigley talks about.
Yeah, and I was the Bank of International Settlements is an interesting entity. It enjoys territorial inviolability as also extraterritoriality privilege.
Yes, it's a Disney, Washington D.C., Vatican, Jerusalem, Tel Aviv style city state, isn't it?
Yeah. And in the book, the interview that you had posted on your website, on your article about the Bank of International Settlements,
mm-hmm.
Adam Labore talks about it, how, you know, he's watched closely as he can't leave the room or be left alone in the room.
Yeah, it's like a secret society or a fraternity of persons. Well, I mean, the whole thing is based on the circle of initiates that Cecil Rhodes cooked up at the behest of the Rothschilds.
And it's owned by it only has 140 customers, the world's central banks, and it's pretty much, supposedly they own the banks. Of course, the question is who owns those central banks?
Exactly, which are private families and cartels, and that's all talked about explicitly by Quigley. No conspiracy there, that's all admitted. And I found it curious too. I think there's only two branches outside of Basel, Mexico, mm-hmm. and Hong Kong. Isn't that correct?
Can you anything to do with drugs, you think?
That's what I was going to say.
Mexico and Hong Kong.
And Mexico is interesting for, I mean, we don't have to get into that, but, you know, the history of the German settlement in Mexico and the influences of Masonry in Mexico,
mm-hmm.
and the destruction of Catholicism in Mexico at the behest of Freemasonry and banking agents. There's a lot of deep deep state stuff going on in Mexico, and of course, yeah, obviously the drug aspect of it, cartels. Yeah.
And the idea that he goes into talking about how well paid people are there, how they like to work there, and they enjoy tax exempt status; they're not taxed on their salaries.
It's yes, like, and that's like why Mexico's a haven of billionaires, as I understand at least. Yeah. I don't know any Mexican billionaires, but
yeah. Well, there's that one who's involved in providing free cell phones.
Carlos Slim.
Yes, who originally I think comes from Levant area.
Yeah, I've heard he's not even, yeah. Yeah. He's not like a Mexican dude.
But he's a big telecom guy down in Mexico, and he's giving him free wireless access internet so they can.
Well, you need that when you cross the border and you need to talk to people at home. I'm not joking. You just go into a Mexican restaurant, you'll see all that. I've even seen pictures of Carlos Slim in those Mexican restaurants.
So, but, But with the Bank of International Settlements, again, it's almost like the IMF, where once the reparation payments are ended, it's really it should have dissolved itself, correct?
Well, yeah, but you have these tremendous amounts of interest that are exacted each year. Yeah.
So it's like Bretton Woods collapsed. The IMF didn't close up shop because Bretton Woods, the IMF was there to, I guess, make sure that there's a exchange,
something to come in its place.
Yeah. So what you get out of the First World War is, of course, you get the Versailles Treaty and the reparations and the war guilt clause, which justifies the reparations and the payments and the raping of Germany, which sets the stage for the crisis of the 1930s.
Absolutely. And Hitler will actually mention this in Mein Kampf as well. Mm-hmm. So this is known to be, you know, one of the obvious causes. I don't think conspiracy involved in that. But if you read Mein Kampf, he does speak of this. He talks about the ridiculous debts that have been placed upon Germany by the bankers.
And also in the United States, of course, in the 20s, we had the 20s boom, the roaring 20s. And that was fed largely by the Federal Reserve under Benjamin Strong, who was working with Montague Norman at the Bank of England. Ostensibly, that was done to inflate the value of the English pound because it had suffered so much inflation or devaluation during the war.
And yeah, England, I was going to say that the quick. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. Go ahead.
But England wanted to return to the gold standard at par with the dollar. That wasn't possible. Really?
Yes, Quigley talks about this, that the British economy suffered, and as a result of all this, and this is really what allowed the U.S. to move into a situation of economic supremacy globally.
And I think it was the Genoa Conference which instituted the gold bullion standard, which superficially maintained the English pound as the dominant reserve currency. But that was only done because Benjamin Strong was there to deflate the dollar, to prop up the pound, which fed the stock market boom and the real estate boom in the United States and the credit boom internationally, which set us up for the crash of 29, correct? And that's how I remember the rendering of the history of that period.
That would make sense. You would probably know more about that than I do. I just recall that Quigley does make these kind of broad statements that the economic crises of these decades are, I don't want to say engineered, or he uses some term to the effect of organized or engendered, I believe is the term he uses. Yes.
But I think this was foreseen by plenty of people like, what's his name? The pilot flew to Paris, 1927.
Lindbergh?
Lindbergh. Yeah. Charles Lindbergh's father was a senator. Father. And when they created the central bank, when they created the Federal Reserve System, in his speech, I don't know verbatim, but he said that from now on, booms and busts will be engineered by the bankers, by the money trust.
Oh, okay. I didn't know Lindbergh's dad said that.
So these things were kind of foreseen. And, of course, this goes back to the 19th century and some of the disputes in America regarding the bank, the first and second bank in the United States. And when Jackson successfully shut down the second bank in the United States, in response, politically, the head of the Bank of the United States, Nicholas Biddle, called in all the loans to create a deflationary crisis.
Yeah, I believe that that is mentioned in relationship to the stock market crash. Yes, by Quigley.
Oh, it is. Okay, that's interesting. It
I
doesn't
believe
mention
he
no.
does mention that, yeah.
Does it also mention how J.P. Morgan engineered the 1907 crisis to create the justification for the Federal Reserve law?
I can't recall, but he may.
Okay, that was the Knickerbocker Trust Company, which they started a
Okay.
rumor mill around New York that it was going under. And of course, it went under because all these banks are by design unstable, which is an important point.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's a good point.
And this created the need for a Federal Reserve to create monetary elasticity
Oh, yeah. Okay. And right. Well, the regulatory bodies are supposed to be there under the guise of providing stability. But that's not, of course, what they're actually there for.
because they thrive off the instability.
Instability, exactly.
It's you know
And
it's
I really do think that I know that I made this point many times. I think I made it with you last time, but it's a point that Alan Watt makes that it is planned out in decades. And so that's how we know that that's you can have a period of privatization, and you have to look forward to the energy and production and resources that a people will create in the future. And that's what I thought was very telling that we got into last time, that most people don't ever think or talk this way, is that they have foresight to see, okay, we're going to have a privatization period, and then we're going to have a New Deal period. And Quigley is very explicit, as I'll get into when I get to that section, that the New Deal was all at the behest of the bankers too.
I think you made the point that, it was funded by banker debt.
Is. That's what Quigley says, right?
And so FDR, despite his boast of being a traitor to his class, was serving his class.
And now Quigley pictures him as an idiot who didn't realize that he was running up all these debts to the bankers. But who knows, right? I mean, like Gonzalez points out in his book that what the CFR and these entities do is recruit persons to fulfill this office of presidency who can easily be manipulated. So, and let them think that all these policies are their ideas and things like this, and it's all Colonel House or whoever the handler might be, banker handler.
And the important point is when you have a boom and a bust and a collapse of the market, some of these firms may appear to lose money in monetary terms, but they gain in consolidation. And so that's the important point.
Yes. The well, we've seen this many times with BCCI or any of these kinds of things. It could be shell corporations or banks that are fronts for money laundering or any kind of, you talked about this quite a bit. But it can also, the collapse can happen by design. That I think what the term Max Keiser uses is fire sales, right? That if you collapse a nation's economy, then the public or national assets or things like this that have been collected together under periods of socialism, which is what we've seen in Greece, Spain, this is why socialism is doesn't work, and why it constantly is a failure, and it just puts everybody's wealth into a pile, and then the bankers come in after the country's collapsed and they buy up the assets. Private persons come in to purchase Greek islands or whatever it is that has to be put up for sale. And that's been the same strategy all along. And what's amazing is that, okay, so if Joseph Stiglitz writes a book about this and he comes out, and then Greg Palast writes that article about the globalizer who came in from the cold. And that he's, oh, here's this big IMF plan. This is the plan that they used 100 years ago. It's not the IMF's plan, it's just the old plan.
Well, I think a good example I think of that would be what happened with Russia in the 20th century.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, because look what
And then in the
happened.
90s, yeah.
The raping of Russia in the 90s, how all these Wall Street went in there with Jeffrey Sachs and the Harvard boys, and they
Larry
organized,
Summers, yeah.
this fire sale of Russian resources, and all these Russian billionaires that we heard of were agents of Wall Street.
Right, yeah, and they had all these deals with the KGB colonels, right? Who are Russian mobsters. Yeah,
And they can,
absolutely.
and that's also what happened with Milosevic in Yugoslavia.
Yes, Estelin has a chapter on that, right?
I think Madeleine Albright and also General Wesley Clark were cashed in on some sort of telecom company that was set up in the Balkans after all that.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't have to, I just remember reading about that. I can get the details on that, but I think yeah, they cashed on. You know, they cash in on no bid contracts or these corporate deals. And I think what your point you made in this in your second part is, oh, was it a second or maybe another interview I did with you to talk about what we're dealing with here is the corporate state. And
Well, there was another thing I wanted to ask you about that Quigley touches on that he doesn't go into much detail with it, but he says that the BIS will be in charge of the global exchange rates and that they would have it, their own secret books. Now, that to me suggests just ripe skullduggery but I don't know. He doesn't say exactly how it goes down. He just says that, oh, this is how they're gonna control it, but it's for stability. So they're gonna control all these rates, presumably interest rates and all that too. They'll set all these standards, and but it's all for, you know, everybody's good, so that we don't have a boom bust cycle. Now, there's always constantly boom bust cycles, though.
Yeah.
There's no stability despite all of these regulatory experts that are set up, economic so-called experts, who are constantly wrong, but they're still the experts, right?
Well, it's like the Federal Reserve being there to stabilize the value of the dollar. It's lost 98% of its value since the Fed has opened its doors.
There you go. Great point.
And oh,
But
no longer we're going to scientifically arrange it so we no longer have booms and busts. And look at, well, there's some little thing called the Great Depression that occurred on the Fed's watch. There's
and
also,
then the later depression a few years later.
yeah. Yeah. And I was just listening to, oh, it was in 1969, I think, when Nixon just was elected in the fall of 69. There was a discussion with David Rockefeller that said we were going to have a depression in the 70s. And of course, you get that by 1973. Now, they don't call it depression anymore. They call it recessions or down. You know, but they call, well, we just have a recession. You know, it's not a depression, you know, as if there's any difference. But again, these things are engineered largely, you know, yeah, I mean, you'd be tempted to say this is just a product of fiat money and mismanagement, central banking mismanagement, because there's a knowledge problem. That's what the Austrian school would criticize it as such. As these things occur because you just, no one can manage an economy. No one has the information to do this properly. You need the decentralized wisdom of the market out, which I think on its own is a sound analysis, economically speaking. But reality is there are people who have their hands on the levers of power, you know,
Well,
who.
that's the thing is that it's like Paul Craig Roberts has talked about for a long time is that the gold standard can be manipulated. Any of these standards can be manipulated. And this is getting into territory that's not my expertise. I've read a decent bit on economics, but the fact that he says that the BIS can manipulate the exchange rates would lead me to presume that any of those markets could be manipulated precisely by that fact.
Well, they steal the gold and or they do something else with it or you know, a good example is of stealing gold. You mentioned FDR when FDR issued his executive order
You couldn't cash in gold anymore.
invoking a World War One, I think Trading with the Enemy Act or something to do this.
Mao did the exact same thing, by the way.
Yeah, they all do. They all steal the gold,
Right.
right? I mean, that's what they all steal the gold. And then what happens to the gold? It gets, you know, supposedly stored up at Fort Knox. Now, is it still there?
It's in Montague Norman's underground
Yeah,
base.
exactly.
Right.
And if you of course, you've heard the rumors regarding Yamashita's gold or Operation Golden Lily, the Japanese, and how they stole all that gold, you know, during their occupation of Asia during World War.
And then I think Dr. Farrell treats this at length, and it gets very involved. But he talks a lot about the bonds being a big scam, and there being all these fake bonds and things like this.
Yeah, well, didn't those Japanese guys arrested in Switzerland with like a face value of $1 billion or multi-billion-dollar bond issues, and they said they're counterfeit? He says, well, if they're counterfeit, it means that there have to be some real ones out there.
Right.
And this gets into the black budget, the Black Eagle Trust,
Exactly.
you know, and the off the books funding, and that gets to a whole other area of like, you know, the breakaway civilizations. But,
yeah, and who even knows, you know, what or how much it is, right?
And that, yeah,
and that ties in, that gets into these underground bases and stuff, which Sophia and I talked about. But I thought it was funny that I was reading Quigley and I was like out of nowhere. I wasn't expecting to see him mention an underground vault with, you know, Blofeld style traps to flood the basements when, you know, anybody tries to get the gold.
Well, like when, if you're dealing about the missing billions at HUD during the 80s with Catherine Austin mm-hmm. Fitz, or the missing trillions at the Pentagon, and you're not wondering where that money is going. You know, or the, you know, the fake space program where, you know, for a few million,
yes.
they can put on a show and steal $40 billion to spend somewhere else. But the bottom line we're dealing with is you're dealing with a secret, like in this book, this guy wrote about the Tower of Basel, is they're secretive, and they have to be secretive because they have to be free from politics and public distraction. But wait a second. Are these people disembodied angels that they can be trusted with such power? And
of course. Just like when I was passing the Rand Corporation yesterday and I saw the big atomic chain link statue of a explosion that they have in front. They're good people. They're going to provide a rational analysis. There's no worries or concern.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like their analysis to the Pentagon is always, we need more funding to provide more analysis. It's very rational.
So, it is. And, Obamacare, that's very rational. That was a brilliant Rand idea. Yeah.
Yeah. That's right, and people blame Obama for that when the Republicans were up there.
Like he could come up with that, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wait, is he typing up these 10,000 pages while he's out golfing, or? I guess when he pulls his BlackBerry out and he's writing Obamacare in between golf swings.
Didn't he just have a recent appearance on the Tonight Show?
I don't know, probably, but he did this SNL style skit not too long ago, so.
Yeah. So. Yeah. He's, you know, how he runs the country and does that at the same time. It's incredible.
Well, it's an amazing, it requires a special kind of person,
mm-hmm.
A man of virtue, a man of excellence, a man of the people. Anyway, but, I want to thank you, Tim. thank you, Tim. This is Brock Angel Obama here. Tim, you do a great show. Okay. It's wonderful, but I'm a man of the people. And our Muslim friends, they're not here to kill us.
Hey, I mean, obviously you're calling FDR out as a tool for the banker elite. Now, of course, this conflicts with Webster Tarpley's analysis of FDR.
No, listen, FDR is a hero. Wall Street, okay? FDR stands up against Wall Street. Wall Street are the villains. Austerity.
Yeah, but what but, obviously
not according to Quigley.
Yeah, but you need obviously gold is there to discipline the bankers, to discipline government, to keep budgets balanced.
You would think, yeah.
Yeah, but of course, but yeah, but yeah. You said again, it's one of these things where it's gold. Or, you know, some sort of commodity standard works if the people dealing with it are honest and they're accountable. The problem is they've created these secretive Masonic systems that aren't that destroy all accountability.
Yes. So. That's the problem with most of the philosophies of economics and systems is that they are all projected based on a world that's operating one way. And then you have the other world, which is the real world, which operates in terms of scams and trickery and espionage and deception. And that's why, according to Gonzalez's analysis, the way that the Rockefellers were able to rise to total domination in the U.S. was precisely because they were unethical. Granddaddy Rockefeller, was known to be a con man, a mountebank, snake oil salesman, and would brag about all the villainous things he could do to cheat people. He would even cheat his own sons, he bragged, so that he would teach them a lesson, right?
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, point being is that that's the, you know, the great heroes that documentaries on History Channel will say, well, they pull themselves up by their bootstraps, right? Sam Walton.
Yeah.
But no, I think it's our first interview that we did, or one of the first ones, where if you watch Back to School with Rodney Dangerfield, and he's got the orthodox economist up there like, sir, have you read Keynes? And Rodney Dangerfield says, I don't know, but I know I need to grease the local cops.
Yeah. Who's going to pay for waste management? Those guys, tell you that, those guys don't play nice.
Yeah, right.
And what about the local politicians? Man,
Yeah.
they want their part, you know.
Well, that's how it really works. I mean, you know, whether we, I mean, I'm not saying we shouldn't have an economic system, or a, we should, I think, you know, strive to have as just a system as possible. But
you got to also have to face reality.
Exactly.
Yeah, did you ever see a movie called, it's called a game, it's called A Very Dangerous Year or Violent Year?
Most Violent Year.
Most
yeah,
Violent
I
Year.
It. That's a great,
that
another
a great,
great analysis. Yeah,
and
that's a good point.
And I watched that movie and said, you know, this is this. Everyone's trying to destroy this one guy. He's trying to do it. In the end, he learns the only way his company stays afloat is because his wife cooks the books and breaks the law.
Exactly. I was going to say, yeah, Jessica Chastain's got this secret set of books that she's been keeping for him, and she's the actual secret behind the throne there. And because the whole thing is about to collapse because they're going to be investigated by the IRS or FBI or somebody.
Well, the local DA who
that's it, yeah.
simply wants to shake him down. Mm-hmm. And the he's thinking it's because we provide a better product, better service, and he does, but that's not enough. That is not enough. You have to play with the big boy. And in the end, he lectures the other crooks. He says, listen, take some pride in your work. I'm naively thinking he'll shame him into playing fair, and that's not
right.
how it works.
It's a great point. Yes. I forgot that that was illustrated in that film. Yeah.
So I recommend the movie. Just watch it because that's what doing business is. That's what it's worth.
Yeah.
You know, and again, yeah, and also the danger of that genius thing in Back to School, that scene in the classroom with the professor who, you know, lives in this fantasy academic world, and Rodney Dangerfield actually made it in the real world.
Right, right, yeah.
You know, he turns around. Of course, he's the one that endows the university that pays. You know, like Rockefeller, they open up these universities to have people teach this fantasy world that people live in. You know.
Yes, the synthetic overlay. And, And I thought, go ahead.
But we're talking now. You made the point in this part of your series about the conflict that led to World War II, and Quigley states, if I recall from your lecture, that it was these financial scams and debt which led to World War II. It wasn't evil Nazis or Hitler wanting to take over the world.
Well, there's a combination of interests. So you did have the rise of these kind of nationalist movements, which, you know, all the bankers and the globalist types have known that when you do these kinds of things, you get a nationalist reaction. And they've known that for a long time. Mm-hmm. So you did have that element there. There was obviously genuine reaction to the Western engineered Atlanticist banking cabal. Mm-hmm. Exacting these ridiculous amounts of reparations. So there is genuine anger amongst the personages who, you know, are feeling this. You also have the enrichment, obviously, of certain persons in Germany and certain classes who that plays into the class dialectic, you know, which the Nazis were, of course, a workers' party. So all of that is real. But then, you know, the skullduggery of what exactly is going on with, you know, to what degree Hitler is an ally of the Cliveden set at first, and then to what degree he's, you know, allowed to be built up. And we get the impression from Quigley that many of them wanted him to be built up because, well, there were multiple reasons, but they, you know, they wanted this fear of war and attack on the part of Germany. Mm-hmm. And the British wanted this. That's the whole point that Quigley does say, is that they did want to build him up. They did want a period of alliance, and then they wanted war.
And this is foreseen.
Because what does what does that war do? Quigley says it weakens a lot of these states. Mm-hmm. So it's not, I mean, in other words, I'm just saying it has multiple facets.
Yeah.
It doesn't just wreck a place, but war also weakens. I'm trying to remember. I think he says, a lot of the countries that would sign on to fighting would be tremendously weakened as a result. One of those is, I think he says, Italy. Mm-hmm. So Italy was tremendously weakened throughout these wars, and it really well, it's just that whole old strategy of getting people involved in foreign entanglements.
Yeah.
And that's a great psyop on its own.
Yeah. And of course, in Germany at the time, you also had the cultural factor, like the moral corruption of Germany with the great inflation, and the exploitation of Germany because of that great inflation led to the Nazi reaction to the Weimar culture, which was portrayed in that 1972 movie, Cabaret.
Okay.
Yeah, Cabaret, where it's, again, it's the revulsion, the pornography and the...
Well, I was going to say, yeah, that you see this pattern pretty consistently even now, where the Western toxic culture then invades any place where the warfare and the bankers have been.
Yeah.
The war comes, then the bankers come, and then comes Marilyn Manson and, all this stuff.
So, but what's interesting is the, again, what happens is you have this... the reaction in Germany, and of course, at the same time that they're creating the conditions that destabilized Germany internally, leading to the rise of the Nazis, they're financing German economic development. But this is the doctrine of free trade, where the British Empire preaches free trade, and societies start to trade and expand, base their economies on that free trade, and then they're blockaded.
Yeah, there's a double-edged sword to the free trade where it's and there was two models, both the Reich and the Atlanticist powers had the bloc free trade model, except that the free trade was weakening Germany's economy because you had this global system that if you are excommunicated from this system, it hurts your economy, and so Germany needed tariffs. This was another part of the war. Was that they needed to have these tariffs on imports and exports for their economy. And they wanted to be independent from the Atlantis system. Of course, the Atlantis couldn't have that. So that was another reason to have the war, is that, as we said before, the two main threats, which even the Stratfor guy said recently, the West has always seen Germany and Russia and an alliance between Germany and Russia as the main threat to Western power. So, so you have to weaken Germany. That's weaken and destroy Germany is really, I think, the main point of all this.
And what Germany was doing, I guess, first Hitler, Hitler abrogates the Versailles Treaty, stops all reparation payments. At the same time, he brings a certain amount of order to Germany, which has a certain amount of, I guess, economic benefit right there. But what happens is he arranges all these bilateral trade agreements with these European states. So they're able to develop economically outside the Anglo-American banking order. This is a reaction. Remember,
that's what Quigley talks about. Yes, he does.
And doesn't happen in a vacuum. This is a reaction because during the First World War, you had Britain's, illegal hunger blockade. And Germany knew that they had to break out of that that dilemma. No, and that's where you get the doctrine of Lebensraum.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Germany needs to expand and not be vulnerable to England, to be blockaded again. But again, England there is supposedly the advocate of free trade when it suits her balance of payments. But
that's what I was going to say. Yeah, free trade is selectively applied.
And when you go off the gold standard, repudiate, by the way, you're repudiating the gold standard. But what you're really doing is you're saying we're not going to pay our bills anymore. We're just going to print. And once you start doing that, you don't have free trade anymore because then you're able to manipulate currencies.
But I would also add that Quigley makes the point, and this could be because of his kind of third wave perspective, I guess, is where he goes with things. But because he is representing the CFR, is that Quigley says that the banking cartels wanted free trade because they didn't want any kind of regulation or infringement upon their internationalism. So it's not free trade. People hear this, they think, oh, that means libertarian freedom for me. I can drive to Mexico and buy my pot or whatever. No, free trade is for, Coke, Pepsi, and Ford to dominate markets and not have any, to move out of any kind of tax restrictions or things. I'm not saying that the taxes are good. It's very complex, but government taxes on things, can at times be detrimental to an international corporation. So you might want NAFTA and GATT and these kinds of things, because they're really only catering to, or the TTP, TTIP. I mean, these are really just catering to this top establishment that we're talking about.
Which distorts the market, because
absolutely,
because how do you, that you, what you're doing is you're stifling up and comers, would be competitors.
Absolutely.
You know, you can't compete, and this is the same thing that why you get, how you get this, one of the reasons why you have such corporate consolidation is because mega corporations like Walmart can negotiate. You know, they get breaks on, they, if they move into an area, they'll sign a deal where they don't pay property tax.
And this is why what happens with a lot of people who are trying to build a company is that they're actually advertising their company to be sold.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you're building it to a certain point, hoping that you'll get bought out.
Yeah.
So,
And this,
and the people that buy you out are, you know, it's like, oh, you know, Disney's going to buy, you know, all these other things. Walmart, hasn't Walmart recently purchased some kind of local mart that offers?
Yeah.
I don't know, but this kind of thing happens all the time.
Yeah, and this is a shame, because what happens is this has real, I think, cultural, societal, and political impact. A good example, I was doing some research on the America First Committee.
Uh-huh.
You know, they're probably the most successful anti-war groups in the United States. Of course, they were besmirched as being pro-Nazi because they didn't support...
Because they didn't support World War II, yeah.
Yeah, World War II. And, of course, one of the big things is when Charles Lindbergh gave that speech blaming the Eastern establishment, Britain, and the Jews for dragging the country into the war is considered a gaffe because he was being anti-Semitic. But remember, mm-hmm. Michael Kinsey said about a gaffe, he said a gaffe is when you accidentally say something that's true.
Something true.
Yeah, that's precisely where the people dragging country into the war at that time, 1941. But my point here is that movement was backed by a lot of local regional businesses.
Yeah,
that had local and regional loyalty as opposed to the empire. When under the corporate structure, you don't get that. You get Google boycotting North Carolina for not letting men in women's bathrooms.
Yeah,
you know, something like, or PayPal or something, or some other corporation, you know, Nike or something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there was a big difference because when before everything was corporatized and internationalized, they had loyalty and some sense of they had some regard for the areas in which they lived, local patriotisms. These things, you know, I think that was your point regarding free trade. Is free trade is there to impose globalism?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
and that's, I mean, Quigley is explicit about that. He says that is a key central strategy for the internationalists is mm-hmm. to have free trade. But it's not what you think free trade is, right?
No, it's not the idea of just removing barriers and honest friendship and trade with other people. It's these 1,000-page trade deals. It's imposing global intellectual property, which is there to stifle all creativity. And
yeah, under the guise also of international laws, which are themselves concocted by the bankers to just have monopolies is this whole thing. That's all it is. Yeah, and that, but it is a key part of the very plan of the New World Order has always been to have continental trading blocks, right? And how do we know that? Well, because Marx said it. Marx said that would be the big path on the way to the New World Order.
Mm-hmm.
And Marx was an agent of the bankers. Absolutely.
And a good example.
So it is Marxism. Don't ever misunderstand that ultimately it is Marxism, but Marxism is kind of a front, you know, it's this set piece, right. That kind of transforms into new things. And you know, because Marxism and fascism and communism and socialism and, They're all ruled by a bureaucratic elite.
Mm-hmm.
What it is. And this is why Quigley, by the way, he'll have a chapter where he talks about the third way and how that is 100% where we're going in the future. And he does explicitly say the entire technocratic future will be governed by managerial experts and bureaucrats.
Yeah, which is why the...
So I'm presently in a state where they do this. They test run this experiment at 20 years ahead of the rest of the country, where the bureaucrat can write you a ticket for your smog account on your car. You can be fined for putting a piece of garbage into the wrong can, you know, glass, plastic, right?
Mm-hmm.
All of this. This is a total when you hear military industrial complex, you know, people think of that as like the American empire. It's not the American empire. It's the Atlanticist bankers who have control of the engine of America, which I know you know this, but you can see it much more prevalent when you're on the coasts, be it New York or California, where you get the bureaucratic Agenda 21 style, you know, reorganization of communities and whatnot far ahead of time than you do if you live in the middle of nowhere like I do.
Yeah, that's one. When you recently interviewed Sophia Smallstorm,
right?
And she's made a point when I talked to her. I interviewed her last year, and we were talking about how these grants that are funded with new world order fiat dollars. The local governments are no longer really funded by local tax revenue; they're funded by these grants, at least a large portion of their budget. And a lot of the developments going on there, whether it's this, you know, a local swimming pool, park, and of course, what's happened is, it'll cost $10 million, and they'll get $20 million for it, and they'll pocket the $20 million and do something else with it. But they'll slowly imposing these Agenda 21 things, like they kept back in parking spaces for cars, put in bike paths, make it more inconvenient for you to drive. A lot of speed bumps everywhere, and they're just simply not maintaining the roads.
You can't smoke anywhere. That's now another bureaucratic thing. I'm just giving examples that you're spot on there with all of these rules that just suddenly pop up everywhere.
And they're promulgated in secret or regular. These are regulations, codes, not laws.
Yes, Rosa. I read a good bit of Rosa Corey's book the other day, and she talks about all that, how it's done at the local level, where the foundations and the NGOs come in, and they, under the guise of ecology and eco-friendly green crap, they're really erecting the technocracy.
And they're building these. I think John Adams was talking about these target cities.
He was talking about that not far from where I am, right?
Target, where you live in Target, you buy in Target, live above it. And that's
And if you look at the gentrified areas, they're already kind of set up that way, where you get these kind of shopping center community type things, where you live in this kind of condo area that you just go down a couple floors to the grocery, and then you go down a couple floors to the bar or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah.
But yeah.
And it all appears very hip at first. There's no thought of family, children.
it's designed for loose living and all that, right?
And so they're encouraging that culture, and then it goes back to depopulation.
It's interesting too that just like in Brave New World, it's a very segregated. I'm not making a point for segregation. I'm just saying it's a very segregated caste based system, and so under the guise of a lot of egalitarianism, ironically, is how they cloak all of the class distinctions. And so the bureaucrat class and these kinds of classes are going to have the upper hand. And you see this clearly in the gentrified areas. And so eventually you'll have these places like target cities where you'll be sterilized. If you choose to be sterilized, and you can get it for free and you'll get credits, that's where we're going. And this is, it just blows me. I know I keep talking about it all the time, but it just blows me away that it's all in Brave New World.
Yeah.
That's how he describes how the alpha class lives. The alpha class lives in the gentrified type area, literally.
And what's weird, this is written
32. And you won't need reproduction because you have test tube babies and whatnot. So if you live, your genetics will determine your caste. And so they kind of breed these goblin people to do janitor work.
Yeah.
to throw the sawdust on the vomit and stuff. And then you have these other people who kind of have middle class. It's alpha, beta, gamma, delta people. Epsilons are the worst. And then the alphas, it's just so funny that all the alphas think that they're at the top of the chain, and they're all underneath the world socialist controllers who head up 10 different regions.
Well, this would be the managerial classes, the people that they think they're the smart ones.
Yeah.
And they, because they get paid a little bit more, they support the system. but the people support the system because they're all looking to get paid. And I think it was who was it who said that you can't expect a man to understand something if his paycheck depends on him not understanding it.
There you go. That's a perfect way to say it. Yeah.
And
what's amazing is how anti-human it all is.
Yeah.
The whole system is anti-human, and it's intentionally engineered to go in that direction.
I might have been Upton Sinclair who said that, but I might be mistaken.
Oh, really?
Or it might have been Who Wrote the Jungle? What was his name? It was Upton Sinclair.
Rudyard Kipling.
Yeah. So. Again, what we're talking about is people aren't really free to criticize this stuff because if they do, they'll simply lose their job.
Yeah, Servando Gonzalez mentions a few cases of persons who didn't do what they were supposed to do.
Yeah.
And one of those would be Nixon, who did a couple things that the CFR didn't like. And so you see what happened to Nixon.
Oh, you had Watergate, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which, of course, if you study it, all the principal figures in Watergate had ties to intelligence.
Absolutely.
You know, so. But in this process, when you're talking about this run-up to World War II, you have banker consolidation, the transformation from commercial capitalism, which would be maybe 19th century classical liberalism.
Well, kind of. I mean, would you class the East India Company under Adam Smith?
Well, he worked for him, didn't he?
Yeah, I mean, kind of. But, yeah. But it's supposed to be free market, right? But it's not, because the East India Company is the only licensed crown business for that market.
Yeah.
So I'm a Dyer, and this is a neat little factoid. The Dyers in England are the royal swan keepers. So I'm not joking. My descendants, I don't know how far back, or this is just what my grandmother said. Oh, we're from the Dyers of England. They had the licensure for swans, so nobody else could touch the swans but us.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. And if you the Dyers are still actually the royal swan keepers, if you go look it up. Anyway, point being, that was off the topic, but so if you call that classical liberalism, yeah, even though it's supposed to be invisible hand, but yeah, I mean, that's what it is in my view. And then that transitions into what he calls from commercial to financial. And this is big investment houses. And they would propel the economy through, you know, whatever industries they chose to invest in.
And this required the imposition or creation of central banks,
mm-hmm.
The domination of Wall Street, because if you read about what was going on in the United States in the latter half of the 19th century, was the economy was far too competitive for the Eastern Seaboard elite to tolerate.
Absolutely.
Corporations were funding themselves. I think 70% of all corporate expansion were funded in-house. They weren't borrowing money to expand. They were borrowing off equity, not debt.
This is that point that Quigley makes about how the U.S. got so wealthy and powerful. Yes. Mm-hmm.
So something had to be done.
Absolutely. You can't have that.
I guess you could call this I know it's a bad term, but it's almost like a few decades later when the trilateralists were talking about the crisis of democracy. This is sort of the crisis of economic democracy in the United States. They needed to cartelize the country, and they did that.
You can't have people starting businesses and becoming millionaires. That's not you can't share power.
Yeah. So they create these laws, regulations, central banks. They usher in the era of finance capitalism, which you would say the final process is monopoly capitalism.
This is how Quigley characterizes it. Okay. Yeah, and he's saying this is the transition out of this period where you have large investment houses, this early Wall Street boom period,
mm-hmm.
And this transitions into the all the corporations that grew up that were so successful during this period being consolidated and coming under conglomerates. So you transition out of financial into monopoly.
And so we're in that stage now. This is why we're seeing,
which is why he says the next stage will be third wave.
And the third wave would be something like what, like something we're seeing like in China or something.
Yeah, you'll have a blend. You'll have I put it like this: the worst aspects of socialism, communism, and the worst aspects of capitalism put together into a nice garbage juice smoothie.
I think you put it well with when you're talking about these things. I think you're this time you're criticizing the Austrian analysis, not so much for the economic analysis, but for their overall analysis of reality, because they're not acknowledging the fact that we're led by this criminal cabal of banksters that
Yes.
simply won't allow the market to work. In theory, all this stuff is fine, but I think you stated something like we live in an age of full spectrum dominance.
Yeah.
Do you really think they're going to allow, something like economies to develop on their own?
Organically, right.
Yeah. These you need to in order to control the world, you have to, you have to. Well, in order to control the world, you have to control the world. And so, you're not going to let countries develop on their own. In fact, you're going to retard development. You're going to impoverish them when necessary, inflate, build them up when necessary. And the United States, I think, was the beneficiary of this, or at least the apparent beneficiary of this, for throughout most of the 20th century. Now we're in the age of a sort of a deconstruction or reorganization of the U.S. economy.
It is, and it's granted, third wave is probably an outdated terminology, but that's what it is. It's all the same stuff, just give it new terms, the new economy, right? It is the global model, and that's where it's all intended to go. And it's not about industry and making money and being successful. It's about austerity, and it's about bankrupting, like you said. There will be boom areas, right? Then this will be the big smart city growth areas. I guess people say Singapore is that now. These kinds of chosen cities for to be megalopolises. So I'm sure there will be certain persons that do well in those arenas. But at least from the perspective of the establishment, they're done with capitalism. They're done with whatever you call capitalism, whatever you think of it as. It's the same way that Rockefeller talks about nation states. He says, "What? This is old. We're done with that. That's decades old. There's no nation states anymore."
And I guess you could say that you have these various cities, like something like on the lines we see in the Hunger Games, where you have these
I would say, yeah.
megalopolises full of deviants and fops who just goof, live
Yeah, the
frivolous
hipsters,
lives, the
which I
hipsters.
see here walking in front of me at the beach with purple hair and their hands hanging down, hands flopped over, sort of ninnying about. But what I was trying to say about Third Wave, excuse me, was that, what you see in Toffler and these people that talked about this stuff in the 70s and 80s, and Brzezinski talked about it. And this is, it's not the total end of capitalism in the sense of there being businesses and markets. It's that it will all be under the regulation of a centralized state apparatus. But that centralized state apparatus is not to be understood, in my view, in an Austrian sense, where it's like the individual business versus, this collective estate. It's rather that the collective estate is one. It's a public-private partnership. This is what we see right in front of our face in terms of gentrification, because it's certain businesses, it's certain select entities. Or think about Obamacare. Okay, Obamacare is a great example of this, where McDonald's, right? Certain companies will be exempt, but that this has the effect of destroying doctors, private practice, right? And so what you see with the medical industry is it's not that you won't have doctors or persons who get paid, but they will rather be kind of plugged into this big central apparatus to where everything must be filtered through that, right? And that allows the central corporate state to really control everything. I mean, that's the whole point.
And the Obamacare is such a great example of that, or Affordable Care Act.
Right, because it's not totally anti-cap. I mean, it is in a sense, depending on what you mean by capitalism, but it's this mix that we see. And you're right about China. That's probably a good example. I'm not an expert on the Chinese economy, but I mean, you're gonna have, you know, masses of in poverty. You're gonna have like a cartel of billionaires at the top, trillionaires.
Yeah, it's the new feudalism. So
the new feudal, and they call it a feudal model.
Yeah, but the Obamacare is where everyone's forced to pay into it. And of course, you're subsidizing one type of, you know, allopathic Rockefeller type of medicine with those forced payments. This is one way the system can further tax you, because they can literally force you to pay into a system in which you may not need or want to participate in. And this is how the system feeds itself. A good example is the cancer industry, where the average, I think, cost for treating a cancer patient is $300,000. And you ask yourself, well, you know, if the system were truly competitive, there'd be a market in devising a more effective, cheaper way to treat these conditions.
You would think, right.
Not if you have coerced payments.
Mm-hmm.
You have coerced payments through licensure, you know, American Medical Association is a cartel. So you're forced to support one, you know, cabal or a group of doctors, but the same thing, you through the mandated insurance, you're forced to pay into that system. So everyone is paying increased insurance premiums to support those inflated costs.
Right.
I mean, it's a huge system of it's harvesting.
It is. It's the parasite sapping model. Yeah. Which is what the bankers did to Germany.
And you want to talk about bankers and parasitism and harvesting is the imposition of debt fiat money.
Mm-hmm.
Another example of harvesting, where each dollar that's entered into the system represents debt. It's not
an asset. If you have a hard time understanding this, if you're listening to this, all you have to do is just think about, what is the U.S. national debt? What's this outrageous amount? Why? Well, because of this.
Yes.
This is why there's this massive crazy debt with this calculator that runs at, you know, like lightning speed, just running up every day.
And no one seems to really, really care about it. I mean,
yeah,
because it ultimately does. It is a fantasy.
It is. But it's a reality in the sense that that is exacted upon the progeny to pay it.
Yes. And this gets into our Federal Reserve notes, and also gets into the birth certificates that we're forced to have.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds crazy, but if you think about it, the birth certificate represents a human person.
That's kind of like a barcode.
Yeah, exactly. It's a corporate person, right?
Yeah, you're owned as the part of this incorporated entity, United States LLC.
But as a person, you represent energy that can be. Mm-hmm. Tax. It's almost like the Matrix, right? You
represent, it really is,
energy that can be taxed throughout your entire life, and that birth certificate proves your existence, which is then marketed and sold, which is, you know, probably by these families that own the central banks.
Well, that's the whole idea, as many researchers have pointed out, behind the idea of human resources. Think about Animal Farm. This is the point that Orwell was making in Animal Farm.
Mm-hmm.
The country is a farm, and it's these different types of produce or cattle or animals, and they have a lifespan, and they have a kind of rough worth, right? I mean, so you're going to live, 60, 70 years, you're going to produce XYZ amount, most likely. So, yeah, I have no doubt that all that's actuaried out.
Yeah.
Right? Like, this segment of the population is worth XYZ, and in the next 30 years they will produce blah blah blah, and we can fleece that for, you know.
Well, I mean, that's how they think. I mean, I think it's Larry Summers, when he worked for the World Bank, wrote a memo saying it was okay to dump pollution in Africa because of the life expectancy of Africans was so low to begin with, it didn't matter.
Yeah, it reminds me too of why, you know, the State Department Memorandum 200, which in that document, Kissinger also says that you can. It wasn't just about depopulating Africa; it was also about fleecing them for all those resources.
Mm-hmm. And that's what goes on every day in Africa, whether it's the rare earth metals, the oil, yes. and This also, when you
diamonds, yeah,
diamonds, and this happens in Latin America. It happened in Asia. This happened in Asia, in Africa, where if you force people off their ancestral homelands into these cities, you create a population of cheap labor, and then you can create these sweatshops, and then call out the market, saying, "Well, they have no other option. What are you going to do with these people? They'd be unemployed otherwise. Well, why are they crowded into the cities to begin with?" No.
Yeah, the city model does seem to be a brilliant strategy of social engineering for sure.
Mm-hmm. And that happened in Britain with the enclosure movement.
I mean, yeah.
Then they shipped them off to Australia, and they passed all these laws that made standing around illegal, so you had all these people in jail. So they became slave labor, indentured servitude, and all that stuff. You know?
Yeah, and that's where we're all heading. Even if you're an alpha class, you're going to be a slave labor, basically living in a test tube. You're a part of the science. I agree with Sophia that it's a giant, it's not just a science experiment. It's, you know, I mean, they're not just experimenting. They have a definite plan.
Yeah. Well,
they're
not trying to
figure things out. They have a plan.
Your observations at the, you know, regarding the Manhattan Project was more than just a crash program to build a big bomb. It was much more ambitious.
I see it as a total reworking of the biosphere.
Yeah. And which now we're getting into some, you know, if you get into whether it's geoengineering or transhumanism and these things, and basically, it's they're playing with fire. It's Prometheus, you know.
And this is what DARPA does.
I mean,
this is, you know, that's not even secret. That's what they do.
You know, but it's all about, you know, again, it goes back to what Carroll Quigley is writing in his book, and this, of course, he's writing this in the 50s and 60s. What's that quote you have about the banker's plan?
It's a long-ranging plan to create a global monetary system, something to that effect.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, you can't get any clearer than that.
A global financial order.
Yeah.
Centrally controlled. And you can't get, and of course that broad plan is going to involve all types of, sinister little plots and deals, whether it's fomented wars, crashing economies, undermining traditional society with feminism, gay rights, transgenderism.
Yes.
It's destroying all resistance to this order, because any notion of traditional society or decency or morality is a stumbling block to this agenda.
Anything that could be a potential firewall is a stumbling block that has to be overcome. And that could be local businesses. That could be traditional religions. It could be family, right? I mean, family's big. Mm-hmm. Big jurisdictional unit that's outside of these created entities called states and corporations, right? I mean, the family's a natural institution.
Yeah.
And to wreck that is... quite obviously advantageous. I mean, that's the whole point of all this toxic culture,
is
to wreck all that.
Yeah, and that's when it gets in your research regarding the toxic culture, is this is part of MK Ultra, the broader plan, where everything is weaponized. Pretty much, I think it was Huxley who said something about attacking society on all fronts, cultural, economic, educational, religious. And this is, of course, that full front attack, attacking all fronts, is a necessary step to its full spectrum dominance.
Absolutely. Yeah. You have to break down what exists to rebuild. And that's the, alchemical dictum that we've talked about many times, solve the coagula, right? You have to smash a thing to build a thing. I forget who said that, but it's a philosophical quote from somebody. But yeah, this is the alchemical aspect of it, and whether all the top bankers are practicing alchemists and Satanists, it doesn't really matter, because that's what they're doing, right? I mean, that's the strategy of what they're doing. But yeah, I mean, you can't really pick an area of life and existence that isn't touched by this. And I think that's the telling part.
Yeah.
And it's important, I think, to understand too, that when you start looking into the atomic question and Manhattan and all that, it leads directly to MK Ultra. So those aren't disparate subjects. They're intimately connected, because they're all under the aegis of the military industrial complex and the think tanks studying to re-engineer man, right? I mean, there was that, what's that think tank that's kind of popular, it's gone around, or that document, Changing Images of Man.
Oh, is that the Aquarian Conspiracy and all that?
Well, it's an actual...
Changing Images of Man, yeah.
Yeah, that's it. And you know, that talks about all this reorganization of everything. So, yeah, this is not different from what Quigley's talking about. It's all the same thing.
And to do this, I think you have to... this is part of Tavistock's research, and Rand Corporation, which is an adjunct of Tavistock, is you have to subject society to nonstop trauma and shock, economic, cultural, which is why we get the booms and busts, the wars. This is why we get the sexual revolution, the confusion, gay rights, even weaponized civil rights. All these things, all these causes are weaponized. And yes, that's an old, which is, you know, kind of an old Masonic trick, which I think ultimately what we're dealing with here.
Bernard Berlison 1969 Population Council document explicitly says that the promotion of homosexuality is to wreck population growth.
Yeah. And was it Rumsfeld who talked about the AIDS crisis being a model for the war on terror?
Yes, that's in the declassified PSYOP document that you can find at, I think it's called Info Warfare or something to that effect. Mm-hmm. From 2002 or three, somewhere in there. And yeah, there's a good article at Global Research that has that, but they actually link the PSYOP document. And yeah, it's under Rumsfeld, and it explicitly says, based on how the AIDS information was put out into the public. Yeah.
And well, that's interesting because a while back I interviewed Dr. Nancy Banks.
Yeah, I heard that. Mm-hmm.
And she has memos. I forget what the actual agency, it was a government study. Regarding AIDS, not AIDS per se, but the AIDS scare, and how it was an opportunity to suggest to kids or expose kids to all types of sexual education that otherwise parents would be opposed to.
That's a great point, yeah, because you can talk about, butt sex and oral sex, that's better than normal sex.
And the second grader is going to say, what's sex?
Yeah, and here's a big box of condoms, and so we're keeping you safe, and yeah.
And then they'll say,
why when I went to see U2 in 1998 in Memphis, they were just spewing to the crowd hundreds and thousands of condoms.
That's just,
why is U2 giving me all these condoms and all the thousands of people that were seeing them in Memphis? I mean, I don't mean to get off subject, but it shows the point.
Oh, it's related. It's all part of
it is, because Bono is, of course, you know, obviously in on the global scam.
Yeah, and that's all about demoralizing and degrading society. That's what the rock fest was all about. That's what music was all about. Is the cacophonous rock music was there. I think another Huxley quote. I just recently interviewed Hans Uder, and he's about music, and he was taught. He had a quote that said, if you want to turn your poets and intellectuals into savages, just treat them to the endless cacophonous sound of amplified music and beating drums, and pretty soon they'll be crawling around like savages. Something to that effect. You know? And
it is the drum beat of the continents below.
Yeah.
I'm trying to put that in a nice way, but
well, it's, I mean, the true music. I mean, as enjoyable as that, as rock and roll is, rock and roll.
Yeah, I like rock music.
Yeah, I like it too, but I also understand its corrosive effect. It is the center of gravity. Rock music is the hips. Classical music is the mind, is the head.
Absolutely.
And jazz music was introduced, although I enjoy jazz music. Listen to it when I'm reading, things like that. But it was introduced. Music has always been weaponized. It's always been used to shape culture for good or ill, and leaders of always. Now, we've talked about this before about Plato. Plato talks a lot about music. In China, when there'd be a new ruler, they change the music, the political order, and that's one more way, one more avenue, one more way that the oligarchs can affect society and degrade society, which they've been doing since since the 1950s or 60s.
Great example of that was, it's a ridiculous example, but it's telling, as we were watching Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure not too long ago, which is funny because we're in California, not far from San Dimas, where that's supposed to take place.
Mm-hmm.
And I know this sounds stupid to you. It's the funny part where I think the movie is satire. I really do. And it is illustrative in certain aspects because, of course, you have George Carlin there who's playing this kind of archetype figure. But it kind of fits into the George Carlin critique of America.
Mm-hmm.
And when Bill and Ted go on this journey, of course, they grab certain personages from history and they bring them to the future, the 1980s California, to be part of their senior project in high school.
Yeah.
Now, here's the brilliant part of this movie is that Bill and Ted basically re-educate all of these historical personages from Abe Lincoln to Socrates, right?
Yeah.
To Napoleon, to be culturally appropriate for America. So basically what Bill and Ted do is Americanize history. And so it's a hilarious project in Americanized revisionism, right? So when Keanu Reeves meets Socrates, and Socrates, of course, speaks Greek, and Bill, one of the other ones says, tell him something philosophical. And Keanu Reeves goes, all we are is dust in the wind, dude. Right? And so then when Socrates, now there's a point to this, when Socrates comes to the future, like he's turned into this cool dude, right, for California. And so that's all ridiculous. But the point is, I think, genius insofar as Bill and Ted are the degraded idiot versions of what you're talking about in the 80s phase, right? Mm-hmm. Like that's the idiocy of the youth of America and the future generations, according to the 80s in a kind of Carlin-esque sense. But that's what America does, is that the ideology of America, what America is this kind of inherent revisionist thing that sees everything kind of re-engineered to fit an Americanist revisionist agenda, is what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. And that inherently, I believe, is anti-traditional, anti-cultural, anti-historical. It is the island of, what's it called? In the Tempest, America, I think, is the island of Prospero.
Yeah.
It's the island of illusions, the Brave New World. That's where it comes from, right? So, there is all the advantage in the world to degrading the populace because you're already viewed as cattle anyway. So, and as I understand from, you're talking about the Kaffirs and all that earlier with Sophia and the double books and all this stuff. As I understand it, the Stanford law code does class the population as humans and other animals. Now I may be reading too much into that, but it's in the section on whether it's legal to test on humans.
Mm-hmm.
But we know that the, you know, social Darwinian elite view the population as just cattle anyway. They're just another manifestation of the biosphere. So testing on a monkey is no different than testing on a human.
Yeah. Well, obviously the scientific elite have never been inhibited.
Absolutely, yeah.
I mean, that's like, and that goes back to the Cold Spring Harbor, the Rockefellers, which funded the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute and in Germany, and then of course they, after World War II, they had to change things a little bit, so they created what the
what becomes biometrics.
Yeah.
Which is all just transhumanism now. Transhumanism is the same thing.
Yeah. And there's Julian Huxley who created the, was he the Population Fund, UN Population, UNICEF,
yeah,
or something?
Yeah, and he coined the term, transhumanism, yeah. Right.
So there you go. There you go. So, well, again, on the second part, your summation here of the second part leading into the third, what's the third part going to be? Because you end with the beginning of World War II, I believe.
Let's see. I think the next section, if I recall, I don't have Tragedy and Hope in front of me, but if I recall, it does move into the New Deal period.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll have a good in-depth picking apart of the New Deal, as well as, I think last time we touched on what's happening in other areas of the world, Japan, China, Southeast Asia. These are touched on by Quigley. He deals with the elite in those countries. So we'll get into that. We'll discuss some theories about Sun Yat-sen and then Chiang Kai-shek as well. We'll play into that later. The New Deal period with the bankers and how exactly that was going down. Quigley treats that pretty in depth and shows, you know, the FDR was yet another agent of the bankers, whether he knew it or not. But from there, I believe he will be the important chapter. After that, I think, is the important chapter around pages 400 or 500, somewhere in there. Oh, yeah, there's another. We got to get into the Stalinism section. The Stalinism is interesting because I want to kind of tie in this piece that Kerry Bolton's written defending the idea that Stalin went off script. So we're going to look at that, Bolton's thesis on that, and then the section on technocracy and management by experts, which is what Quigley predicts for the future.
Well, it's interesting because the New Deal also coincides with the development of technocracy at Columbia University.
Oh, yeah, good point. And let's also add that the vice president was an open communist.
Oh, you're talking about the agriculture section?
Yes. What's his name? William. Is it William something?
No, I know if you get his name. I'm thinking he had three vice presidents.
The one that was the open communist who was all into Eastern esoterism and the Great White Brotherhood.
They kicked him off the ticket in 1944 for Harry Truman.
Yeah. Yes.
If you said his name, I'd know it immediately. Just, my mind fails me now. Long day of work and it's late here.
But he's supposed to be, you know, the reason that the dollar bill has the all-seeing eye.
Okay. Yeah, he was the agriculture secretary.
Yeah, yeah.
And he became vice president from 40 to – he was the vice president from 41 to 45.
So here we have one of these communist occultists. What? Which you got to read that if you – I'm sure you probably read it. But listeners out there, if you haven't read Marx's translation of Bolshevik occultism, that's great. And that you'll see this connection that I'm talking about ties into – this the VP, the red VP that we're discussing under FDR.
Yeah, I read that about some of the, like, they were like into like orgies and stuff like that.
They were, but they were into the theories of Agartu and Hyperborea, which, well, I thought that was Nazi. Well, actually, there were quite a few Russians into that too.
Henry Wallace was his name.
That's it. Yeah,
Wallace. Yeah, that's, yeah.
Hello.
I'm sorry. Sorry, I hit my mute button.
Oh, okay.
when are we to expect part three?
Probably in the next few days.
Oh, good. Okay.
Yeah.
To that.
So yeah, that'll be good. And I want to tell listeners too that I didn't divulge all the juicy details to Tim, so I don't want to be unfair to the paid subscribers. There is information, a bit of info that you get in the paid subscription. It's not all being leaked.
Yeah, no, limited, yeah, I know.
A limited WikiLeaks hangout leaking it to Tim.
Again, I, the first part is free, half, and that's great. But as a subscriber, I can attest to the full value of the full lecture. It really is. The second part is particularly interesting.
And I think we'll take some breaks to break up the monotony. Because we'll probably do a lecture on Servando Gonzalez's book and Castro, which I thought's really fascinating.
Oh, cool.
And the Dave McGowan's Program to Kill, which I'll be done with that soon too.
So. Oh, wow. Okay, yeah, because I read that a few years ago. That'd be real interesting to talk about that. I mean, to hear you talk about that. Because that's real creepy, and but it explains a lot. And of course,
I forgot to tell you, Tim. Guess where I went yesterday?
Where?
I went to Laurel Canyon.
Oh.
And I drove up the hill to the Lookout Mountain facility.
Oh, did you see Jerry Alito?
No, somebody said, I don't know if it's true. Somebody said he sold it, so I don't know who owns it. But you go there. And you can see over the fence, and you can see there's some of the memorabilia and relics of the Air Force facility there.
Oh. Still,
yeah, there's a big sign that says, you know, U.S. Air Force Base and so forth. That's kind of put on. It's decor now for, you know, memorabilia or whatever. But
it's an Air Force
but
base.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no landing strip.
Good point. That's because it's a movie studio. Yeah, right.
But yeah, that's of course Lookout Mountain. That's with a high tech special effects in the film production. That's where they claim they produce the testing films of the atom bomb.
Exactly. And all the big moguls and actors and actresses of that time were the only ones that had access to the facility. And I should add too, I didn't realize this, that I feel kind of stupid, but Mulholland Drive is the road that you take to go into Laurel Canyon. Yeah, that's the road you go down. So that ties David Lynch directly into this, and got my fingers crossed. May have an interview with an important member of the Twin Peaks cast. I don't know if that'll actually ever materialize, but I did meet a person who was in the circles of Twin Peaks people. So,
oh, cool. Hey, I just got in touch with Danielle Gansler.
Who's that?
He wrote NATO Secret Armies, Operation Gladio.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And the only problem is he's in Switzerland.
Oh.
Hard to coordinate a time with him.
Weird time, yeah.
But he's willing to do it. So that'd be a good, interesting interview there.
Well, I'd like to know, too, the point that Chris brought up. You know, Lemnitzer was also head of NATO for a while. And Lemnitzer is who proposed the faked news. So I'd like to know if he has any thesis on the stagecraft aspects of pasta of being used in Gladio.
Yeah, that's interesting because that's a whole another dimension into mm-hmm. these things, which many people are fearful of publicly entertaining.
Mm-hmm.
But when you look at, like, as you said, stagecraft is statecraft, is the idea if Northwoods, Lemnitzer did propose fake victims and fake mm-hmm. loved ones. We do know that, or at least we know that in Fletcher Crowdy's book, Secret Team, they would stage shootouts and scenes in Latin America
right.
to destabilize or to achieve some sort of political objective.
Right.
It's a part of psychological warfare. The media, because that's fully integrated into the national security state, you know, obvious example is Anderson Cooper, CIA, right?
Yeah, sure.
But I think we've stated before in the past, there are nods examples of media fakery, whether it's CNN, the fake missile attacks and all these things.
Which Quigley has covered too, going back 100 years ago.
Yeah, and of course you mentioned that the French newspaper with the photograph of Germans celebrating the sinking Louisiana.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Of course, jump into the future. You have CNN and Fox News showing Palestinians celebrating, right?
Absolutely.
Same thing.
Yeah.
You know? And you also have the efforts of C.D. Jackson and the OSS and OWI with the World War II, with the concentration camp films that are now known to be faked.
And the mainstream historians point out Hitchcock filmed a lot of concentration stories.
That's true. And sort of, I think Billy Wilder was involved in that as well.
Okay.
So another director, bringing Hollywood.
Another director, right, yeah. Bringing in the noir era, right.
So there you go. So, again, to look at some, bring it up to some of the more recent events, which you talked about with Chris and John on Hoaxbusters call, is the fact that these things can be easily faked because it just isn't quite as difficult as most people seem to think because, one thing is it's all essentially, you mentioned Patrick Hankerson talks about how these things are all, it's a controlled loop because
the closed loop. Yeah.
Yeah. The federal authorities. Now, I don't know why the FBI would take over the Orlando thing because I didn't quite see the federal jurisdiction there, but maybe I'm just being picky. I mean, what's the federal issue there?
Well, why is it only these big federal cases that take on the month-long media attention?
You know. So it's all trauma. And
what about, I sat and watched 2 hours of Syrian war footage, and it all looks real to me.
Yeah.
And YouTube allows al-Nusra and the Wahhabists to upload hours of graphic footage that have 3, 4, 5 million views.
Mm-hmm.
And they're celebrating the bombing of Aleppo. Where's that?
Yeah. You know. But again,
but no, the only thing that matters is 50 so-called homosexuals that were supposedly killed.
Yeah, and that takes over every that Dominic Cruz cycle, and regardless of how ludicrous it all seems, like you know, like you said, 50 people dead, one gunman. Why do they believe this? Well, because they saw it in an Arnold Schwarzenegger movie. Yeah.
I'll be back. Yeah. Yeah. Right. I watched Commando. There's a clip on YouTube that's funny. And I'm not joking. This is illustrative. So if you go watch Arnold's kill count in Commando, and now you watch that and watch it, it takes Arnold an hour and a half of movie to kill 49 bodies. So this guy busted up in this gay club and knocked him out, you know, in a few minutes, I guess.
Yeah, when it's dark.
But it took Arnold an hour and a half, that, you know, with grenades and machine guns and bazookas.
I like, was it Chris who pointed out, he said, yeah, and Arnold's kind of a big target, right? Rally should have like a midget running around.
So tired. Yeah, the actors being carried out have been... got like a bruise on their knee or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. The one clip where the guy gets carried out, he's wearing these bright red shoes and gets up and they put him down and you don't see any blood or anything, but I said, I'm not there, but I'm skeptical of all these things.
Well, I like what Paul Craig Roberts said this week. He said, where are the cell phone videos? Where are the bodies? Where's the death certificates? Why we never see any of this.
Yeah.
I mean, we live in the age when people sit there and film al-Nusra bombing Aleppo and they'll load it up to YouTube afterwards.
Yeah.
Where, I mean, this is how we live now. Where is the footage of you know, it's just like the Paris attacks.
And all the evidence is social media.
Yeah. Trial by social media, like Patrick points out. Yeah.
A shooter had multiple Facebook accounts.
Well, there you go. That proves it.
Shooter. It was a G4S employee. Was Wackenhut or something?
I thought the media, they always say the internet's not reliable. You can't trust the information on the internet. And then they'll turn around and say that these people are convicted based on social media, right?
His posting. What's the chain of custody for that evidence? Is that even admissible? It doesn't matter because he's dead, right? So, you know.
Well, yeah, there's never, I guess the Boston bombing, we were told Zarnev was taken in for questioning and all this stuff. And
yeah.
The point is that we don't know, and so I think the right approach is the skeptical approach. And if you've seen the mass media lie 100 times over, why would you believe them again?
Yes.
But we forget these things, just like with presidential elections, we forget these things, and we think, as Quigley says, that's why we give you the two-year cycles, so that you'll reinvest in the next guy who comes along and sells you snake oil. Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, if they lied about missile attacks in the Gulf War, why would you believe them to tell the truth about these incidents here in the United States shooting? You know, and the fact that we do now, it's been established that at one point you had high-ranking officials in the Pentagon suggesting fake attacks and fake victims and fake grieving loved ones. And
they don't even mask it, given the Smith-Mundt Act going away.
Yeah. And, you know, and of course, you do have firms that specialize in providing these actors, and you know, like Halo Corporation and things like that, where they have, you know, they have
hyper realistic training, pyrotechnics, yeah.
But some of these some of these cases don't even look real; they look bizarre, and which I think is part of the psyop. So,
well, I mean, why would Sandy Hook be? I mean, you have big alternative media names will say Sandy Hook's fake, and then they'll turn around and say all these so-called Islamic attacks are real.
Yeah.
Well, they look exactly the same as Sandy Hook to me. So, and now the alt-right is all going to support, they're being psyoped because they're all going to fall into supporting gay rights, and gay rights is now going to be considered alternative right and conservative, because that's the only way to stand against the Saracen invaders.
Going to behead us all. Mm-hmm. Post Sharia law. You know, so
yeah. Do you want freedom, liberty, equality, butt sex, or do you want Sharia law? That's your only options, Tim. There's no other possible options. That's the threat we face.
Baseball, hot dogs, apple pie, and sodomy.
There you go.
So there you go.
All right. Well, I'm going to have to run, but yeah, thank you for your talk. And maybe we can talk for part three.
Yeah. When you get that done, well, definitely. Listen, thanks for coming back again and taking the time. I'll let you go.
Sure.
Enjoy, go grab dinner or something. I know it's a little earlier out there, and we'll talk.
I've got to go frolic and ninny and gingerly bounce about on the beach with all the hipsters, and we got to celebrate our pride.
I am very proud.
Orlando strong.
Orlando.
I see that everywhere.
Orlando strong. Okay. Okay, Jay, thanks a lot.
Absolutely, Tim.
When I post this, I'll send you. I'll probably do this, probably post it as soon as probably tomorrow.
Okay.
And I'll send you the link, and you can do the regular linking and all that stuff. Thanks a lot.
Excellent. All right, thank you.
Take it easy. Be safe out there. Bye-bye.
We will. Bye.